The lovely Miss Haddad has an amendment in the hands of the clerk. Clerk will read the amendment.
Amendment number 14 has changed. Ms. Haddad of Somerset moves to amend the bill by inserting after section 103 the following section, section 104.
If there be no objection, the clerk will dispense with the reading of the paper. The chair has none. Question now is on adoption of the amendment. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed nay. The ayes have it. The amendment is adopted. Mr. Jones of North Reading offers an amendment in the hands of the clerk. Clerk, read the amendment.
Amendment number 385. Mr. Jones of North Reading and other members of the House move to amend the bill by striking out section 15, inserting place of the following section, section 15.
If there be no objection, the clerk will dispense with the reading of the paper. The chair has none. Purpose of the gentleman rise. Gentleman offers a further amendment to present to the hands of the clerk. Clerk will read the further amendment.
Mr. Conroy of Wayland moves to amend amendment number 385 by adding the following paragraph. Notwithstanding any special or general laws to the contrary, the provisions of sections 15, section AA to GG inclusive, shall not take effect until such time as 1. The Department of Transition.
If there be no objection, the clerk will dispense with the reading of the paper. The chair has none. Question now is on adoption of the further amendment. Yeah, I know. Chair recognizes Mr. Peterson of Grafton. Please pay due attention to the gentleman at the microphone.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Through you, the members. I hope the further amendment is not adopted. Amendment 385 deals with a lot of the situations that have been studied, pointed out on numerous occasions about some of the problems with the EBT cash assistance and benefit abuse across the Commonwealth. So our amendment deals with a lot of the recommendations that have been talked about. So it doesn't need to be further studied. These need to be implemented. In our amendment, we talk about outlining a phase-in of the photo ID on EBT cards, especially for cardholders over the age of 18. We require cash assistance to be used solely for goods and services necessary and essential for the recipients. Require the phase-in of UPC sorting technology to sort out prohibited items at point of sale. There is a lot of technology that can help us in reducing the fraud and abuse in some of the instances of the EBT cards and cash assistance program. We want to increase, in our amendment, recipient and retailer education prohibit out-of-state EBT card use except in states contiguous in Massachusetts. It would prohibit the use of self-declaration as sole verification for applicant eligibility. Requires all self-declarations to be signed under the pains of penalties and perjury. To have some force of law if someone is saying that they live in such a location that they reside in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts and should be able to receive this type of assistance. And it would work to establish an online payment system for rent and utilities. And this amendment also outlines the gradual implementation of those programs. Now, I don't know why this is so difficult that it has to be studied. And in some cases, these are recommendations that have been made time and time again. But I guess, again, through this whole budget process, this is going to be close to the 12th study amendment. No, maybe the 13th. Why do we need to study this situation? These are recommendations that have been made before, should be implemented, and as recently as a few weeks ago where we were talking with the new commissioner, is looking to phase in a lot of these without direction from us. This makes a lot of sense. A further study doesn't at this point in time. I urge the members to defeat the further amendment, and Mr. Speaker, when a vote is taken, I ask that it be taken by a call of the yeas and nays.
Mr. Peterson and Graffin ask when the matter is taken to be taken by a call of the yeas and nays. Those joining with them will rise. Monitors return the care for one. Second division. 20. Sufficient number having arisen when the matter is taken to be taken by a call of the yeas and nays. Yes. Chair recognizes Ms. O'Connell of Taunton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and through you to the members. Mr. Speaker, this has got to be one of the most studied issues in this House. We just got done with two or three study commissions on this. We know what the problems are in the system. We know how to fix it. And the taxpayers are demanding reforms now. They do not want to see another study. We have no way of knowing how the $415 million in this taxpayer-funded program is used. And that is because 95% of that money is taken out in cash at ATMs. We have no way to track that, no way to know how people are spending it. We do know that the biggest expenditures people have are rent and utilities. This underlying amendment is one that is very similar that Representative and, Holmes and I filed, that you all, many of you, signed on to. It requires rent payment of utilities and utilities online so that we know that people are paying their bills. It is going to help them stay safe in their homes. It is going to benefit the children of people that are on EBT. It also will save people money at ATMs with their fees that when they take the money out. It will save people money on money orders, $150,000 that people spend on fees like that. This is a savings for them. It educates people to online banking, helping them to become more independent, more responsible at paying their bills. And it enables DTA to track expenses. It does, very importantly, stops self-declarations. People right now have the ability to sign their name on a piece of paper, say, I pay my uncle $500 rent, I sleep on his couch, and there's absolutely no verification of that. We have no idea who that money is going to. This will end that practice and protect taxpayer dollars. The taxpayers are not going to be fooled by this further amendment. This blocks the true reforms we need, the true reforms that the taxpayers are demanding. And I can guarantee you, they are not going to forget who voted against them come voting time in 2014. I hope the further amendment is not adopted.
Chair recognizes Mr. Einstein of Revere.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and through you to the members. I hope the further amendment is adopted. Just yesterday, in this building, the gentleman from Ashland hosted an event here at the State House called The Faces of EBT. The featured speaker was a woman named Katie Brandt, and she is a beneficiary, or was a beneficiary, of food stamps and used DTA assistance to help her deal with difficult circumstances. Katie grew up in West Bridgewater, before living in Taunton as a newlywed, and currently resides in East Bridgewater. And she and her husband were well-educated, both holding master's degrees. When the couple's baby turned 10 months old, a string of terrible events occurred. First, Katie's husband was diagnosed with frontotemporal degeneration, which is a neurological disorder with a terminal diagnosis. 4 days after that, Katie's mother died unexpectedly of a heart attack. Shortly thereafter that, Katie's father was diagnosed with early onset Alzheimer's. Let's be clear. Nobody wants to go through what Katie Brandt went through. No one expects their husband to have a terminal neurological disorder. No one expects their mother to pass away from a heart attack and their father to be diagnosed with Alzheimer's, all within the span of 21 days. During these 21 days, Katie became the primary caretaker for three dependents, her husband, her father, and her infant son. In this process, she lost her job, the family's house was foreclosed upon, and she ended up on food stamps. Nobody wakes up one day and says, hey, today is a good day to go on food stamps. Nobody wakes up and says, hey, today is a great day to start living on $618 a month, which, by the way, happens to be the average welfare amount for a family of three. And, by the way, she was not on welfare because she didn't qualify. Stories like Katie's are retold to our offices throughout this statehouse. Week after week, my office is inundated with heartbreaking calls from people like Katie. So many people that we all know go through strings of misfortune. So many in this room we love, and people we love go through strings of misfortune. Again, nobody wakes up and says, hey, today is a good day to go on food stamps. Nobody wakes up and says, hey, today is a great day to start living on $618 a month. Nobody wishes this on anyone, whether it's someone we love or someone we've never met. So when these people call our offices, it's our job to help them. People deserve dignity and the ability to strive to once again be self-sufficient. This issue isn't easy. There's misunderstanding. There's a lot of misinformation. And just like any law that passes in this Commonwealth, there's always someone who will decide to abuse it and abuse our system. I was appointed by the Speaker to serve on the Cashless Commission, which met from October to December of 2012. The lady from Taunton also served on this commission with me. This commission was implemented through last year's budget process. It also included allocating $100,000 to hire a consultant to go through options and finish with a report that had to be filed in both branches of this legislature by December 31st, 2012, which we did. The consultant was the Ripples Group, who worked with the state before. The head of the Ripples Group is a man named Attila Habib, who has an MBA from Columbia and was formerly a consultant for Bain & Company. In the past, they were tasked with studying WIC and the process of having WIC switch from a check to a card system. okay? That study has been ongoing since July 2007. Ripples understood our system and knew the limitation of state services. Through the Ripples group, our commission looked at 9 different options to research, discuss, and ultimately make recommendations on. Every single meeting ended with questions like this. Are there any other questions? Is there anything else we should be looking at? Every single meeting ended like that. The consultants, most of the commission members and their staffs, invested thousands of hours researching the many questions raised and the options before us. The majority of us were very committed to making sure that $100,000 of taxpayer money spent was worth the investment. The commission and Ripples explored 9 options. 1, doing nothing. 2, increased education and enforcement. 3, no cash to high-risk clients. 4, no out-of-state ATMs or point of sales. 5, blocking select ATMs, which we do. 6, blocking select ATMs and point of sales. 7, only giving $100 of cash per month. 8, going cashless. And 9, cashless plus UPC level control. Those were the 9 options we looked at. Some of what the commission concluded was option 8, which was the completely cashless system, would cost at least $3 million to implement and has a yearly operational cost of at least $4.5 million. So things like laundry, babysitting, transportation, they can't necessarily be paid without cash. Therefore, it would severely impact people's livelihoods. Option 7 was only the $100 cash per month. The implementation of this is $4 million and a yearly operational cost of $6 million. And the consultants determined that it's more expensive and brings few extra benefits. Option 9, which was the toughest one, the completely cashless system plus the UPC level control, this commission voted unanimously to reject because the cost was so obscenely high. Minimum implementation cost was $25 million and a minimum of $6 million per year of operational costs. Additionally, it would hurt businesses in this Commonwealth because the cost that the businesses would have to incur to implement the system would be significant. So if we are serious about helping our system operate as efficiently as possible, we need to stop the rhetoric and the grandstanding and look at the facts. This legislature has limited the use of EBTs at various places and merchandise that is non-essential. In this budget before us today, we go even further, such as requiring photo ID on EBT cards. So again, if we're serious about helping our system operate as efficiently as possible, we also have to be serious about helping those people that need and deserve these benefits, people like Katie Brandt. And as the lady from Taunton mentioned in earlier debates today, she said, we should be proactive about protecting our kids. She's right. And these benefits help kids. Kids whose families stretch every penny of the $618 per month that they receive to live. Like I said, no hardworking people want to wake up to life-altering circumstances or experience a string of misfortune. I don't get calls from people that want to abuse the system. My office gets calls from people whose lives have turned upside down and now depend on this very system to help them once again become self-sufficient. That's our job, and that's what this program and other programs help us do. I hope the further amendment is adopted.
Chair recognizes Mr. Chair recognizes Mr. Senator Condro of Ashland.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and through you to the members, and thank the gentlewoman from Revere for her great talk. I just want to follow up with a little piece that she talked about when she talked about the children. And I want just to focus in all of us in the room to think about why we have a welfare system in the first place. We have 20% of our children now in the United States and in this country living in poverty. 20%. 1 in 5 children in this state lives in poverty. You have to think about what does that mean. We all have kids that live in poverty in our district. We've been to their doors when we campaign. We've seen how they live. We see the challenges that these kids and these families face every day.
We know what it's like because we've been to their doors. What we often don't think about is what the future is for these kids. The future is bad health comes, bad health outcomes, bad education outcomes, bad behavioral health outcomes. They can end up using drugs, joining gangs, not graduating from high school. The results that comes out of this group is very different than the group that comes out of our kids that are here in this chamber. Our kids have the advantage. These kids don't. And I think what we need to think about as we move ahead is think about 20% of the next generation coming from these circumstances. So what we're doing here today is we're trying to take care of not only our future, their future. It's all of us in this together, and we need these 20% of these kids to have good outcomes. So we need to continue to work to support these kids. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes Mr. Lyons of Andover.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. You know, the story that you shared with us, the gentle lady from Revere, is exactly why we filed these amendments and why we want to see the reforms that we talk about. We've talked about studies. I don't know whether you've had an opportunity to read the Inspector General's study, but there's a lot of information in there. And I think what we need to recognize is in order for us to make sure that we can provide the services that we all want to have to the people that need services in Massachusetts, is that we have to do it in an efficient manner. Nobody wants to punish anybody. I keep hearing these words, punish, punish, punish. That's the last thing that I want to do, is punish anyone. But at the same time, I think we have to be realistic when we take a look at what's going on with the way our services are being provided. I don't think you can close your eyes to an Inspector General's report that after being told for 12 years that we ought not to have placeholder Social Security numbers, and we're still doing it. I don't think we ought to close our eyes to an Inspector General report that says in order to be eligible to receive benefits, you have to provide attendance records. This report suggests that 60% of our children don't provide the current information to remain eligible. I look at that argument and I say, there might be something wrong with who we're giving the benefits to. And therefore, what happens is someone who needs benefits is denied benefits. So our goals are the same. We're not trying to punish anyone. We want to simply make sure that the rules that we've set up are followed. You've heard me and others say that in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, we have asked the governor to tell us how our money is being spent. For some reason, he refuses to tell us. $1.8 billion are going to people that are ineligible or breaking the rules. We could provide more services to more people. So to suggest that anyone, because we're asking that the rules that are put in place, these aren't rules that we made up. These are rules from the Department of Transitional Assistance. We're asking that the rules are followed. I have no desire. I have a young niece who has two children who is part of this program. I don't want to see her punished. I want to make sure that if she needs her benefits, that her benefits are there. She has a handicapped child who literally she has to carry every minute of the day. Every minute of the day. I want to make sure that my niece's child is taken care of. I don't want to hurt anybody. At the same time, I want to make sure that we provide services consistent with the rules that are set up. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes Mr. Conroy of Wayland.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and through you to the members. I rise, obviously, in support of the further amendment. And I say that with all due respect to the gentleman from North Andover, the gentleman from Grafton, the gentlelady from Taunton, and others who have weighed in on this issue over the course of the past couple of years. This public assistance benefit topic deals, as we all know, with the poorest and most underprivileged people in our Commonwealth. And I would like to just put some context around the type of people who are eligible for these benefits. I would like to talk about the substantial legislative changes that we have implemented here in this body and signed by our governor over the course of the past 3 years, and also try to at least touch upon some of the many unanswered questions that remain today that are good cause for having a cost-benefit analysis and further study on this topic before we go forward with some of the suggestions in the underlying amendment. So let's just start with what these programs are that we're all focused on. There are three issues that we are talking about and have been talking about for the past couple of years. The first is the SNAP program, the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, commonly referred to as food stamps. We have discussed in this chamber over the past couple of years the problem related to trafficking of SNAP benefits. That is not necessarily the topic of focus of the underlying amendment, so I'm going to set it aside for now only to say that if it is conflated, as it has been in the past, with cash assistance benefits related to the Temporary Assistance to Families with Dependent Children program, then I will seek to clarify further why these are separate programs. SNAP, of course, run by the United States Department of Agriculture. It is a federally funded program implemented at the state level. TAFDC is, as many of you know, both a state and federal program implemented by the state and overseen largely by the state. We're talking about 52,000 very poor families here in the Commonwealth who are eligible to receive TAFDC. And in addition, we are talking about a program called Emergency Assistance to Elderly, Disabled, and Children, EAEDC, another 22,000 families, people who are over 65, people who are taking care of the disabled in their home, people with children who need daily care. These are not privileged members of our society. We need to keep that in mind and in proper context and perspective as we address these very important issues. So when we talk about the third issue here that we are addressing, we've got SNAP and trafficking, we've got alleged misuse, of cash assistance program primarily through TAFDC. But as we think about those elderly and those disabled people and those children, do we really want to focus on misuse of those cash assistance benefits when these are folks who, for all intents and purposes, do not see a path out of the impoverished circumstances that they live in? They are disabled. That is not going to change. They are elderly. They are not getting any younger. They are children and do not have control over their own destiny, nor can they go out and get income on their own. So let's try to keep that in perspective. There are families that we are talking about here with TAFDC who are making below $1,000 a day. Let's just put that in context, folks. That's, $1,000 a month. That is less than $12,000 a year. And when you add up both the SNAP benefits value, which is just food assistance, and we add up the TAFDC assistance, you're talking another $600 a month, another $7,200 a year, and guess what? These extraordinarily privileged people are now living on something akin to $17,000 a year or $19,000 a year, which keeps them, quite frankly, for a family of three, which is a typical family on TAFDC, an unwed mother or a mother whose husband or the father of the two kids that she's taking care of has split the household. We are talking about people who are living under the definition of the federal poverty level. So we are not even affording these folks the kind of benefits and the kind of opportunities to get work and get themselves out of poverty. We are giving them the absolute bare minimum so that they can put food on their plates, keep shelter over their heads, and have some shirts and clothes and pants on their bodies. The absolute basics. Let's keep that in mind as we are talking about this program. And let's also remember that the folks on TAFDC that we're talking about are on temporary assistance. The folks who are eligible to work or get an education so that they can get the kind of training to get work are only on eligible for these benefits temporarily, 24 months out of a five-year span. I'm sorry. This is not a permanent welfare program. Let's get rid of that perception. And as I mentioned earlier, these folks are either caring for the disabled, they are over 65 often, they are participating in the Mass Rehab Commission programs because they are blind or deaf or have other mental or physical disabilities. We heard from the gentlelady from Revere the example, a tangible example of someone who has received TAFDC benefits in the past. Here's another one. A mother in Lawrence with a young child. She's working at a part-time job because she can't afford to have a full-time job because she can't afford child care. She's waiting for a child care subsidy and a benefit, but you know what? She's in line along with 25,000 other young women who are working, who have young children, who cannot get child care for their children. So she's forced to make a total of $700 a month. And her rent happens to be $750 a month. So when we talk or people propose about a cashless benefit system for SNAP or for TAFDC, or they want to limit the amount of cash that people can have access to after rent is paid and after those utilities are paid, and this poor woman doesn't even have a dime or two nickels to rub together after paying her rent on her part-time job, well then, what is left for her to do? Ladies and gentlemen, I would also like to take a moment to focus on the legislative changes that we have implemented over the course of the past couple of years. In 2011, the governor signed into law a prohibition on using cash benefits for lottery tickets, tobacco, and alcohol, in part in response to work that we did in this chamber. Last year, we extended and expanded that list of prohibited items, and we prohibited retail locations where cash assistance could be used. Let's look again at that list. It is very relevant because it speaks to all the great work that we have done in the past. They cannot use their cash assistance benefits at liquor stores, at casinos, at adult-oriented entertainment establishments, at firearm dealers and ammunition dealers, at tattoo parlors, manicure shops, rent-to-own stores, jewelry stores, or on cruise ships. They cannot buy alcohol, tobacco, lottery. They cannot gamble. They cannot buy pornography, firearms. They cannot buy vacation services, tattoos, jewelry, and court-ordered fees. But they do need cash, indeed, to be able to get to work if they work a part-time job. They do need cash, potentially, to take a cab for their sick child, like my mother did or tried to do many, many years ago, but didn't have a quarter to her name And when she asked three or four neighbors whether they could help her out because little Tommy was so sick that she didn't know what to do with him, even though she was a registered nurse and my father was on a 36-hour work shift and couldn't come home, and Mom didn't know what to do. She was in tears. And on the fourth neighbor that she asked for, the neighbor said, "How much money do you need?" And my mother said, "I need to get my son to a hospital. I need subway fare." And the neighbor gave her a $5 bill, and my mother broke down in tears because she had not seen a $5 bill in 3 months. These are the kinds of situations that people here in Massachusetts are facing every day. The kinds of folks that are receiving TAFDC benefits. The kinds of folks who want to get out of poverty. The kind of folks who believe in the good work ethic and the American spirit that all of us believe in and want to encourage. These are the kind of folks that need our help. They don't need a hand out. They want a hand up. They want to grab onto that bottom rung of the middle class ladder and pull themselves up. That's what these programs are about. Now, there are many unanswered questions with regard to the underlying amendment and why we need a study. How will we enforce the language in the underlying amendment? How much will this enforcement cost? What burden is it placing on retailers who would be forced under this underlying amendment to purchase sophisticated computer equipment that the small mom-and-pop shops do not own currently, that they cannot perhaps afford, that the Retailers Association of Massachusetts finds particularly burdensome and is one of the reasons why they oppose this underlying amendment, sensing that they will put small businesses out of work and out of business and lead to further unemployment? Is that what we want here, folks, during this financial crisis that we are living through? We don't know the answers to this question, and so let us slow down and do a cost-benefit analysis. And what monetary benefit are we talking about in terms of helping taxpayers by eliminating the misuse of these funds? Well, let's go to that Cashless Commission report and the Ripples Group and look at what they found in terms of inappropriate spending of cash assistance benefits. What'd they find? They found out that in cash assistance transactions, purchases of daily living needs, food, clothing, and shelter, that in 99.6% of those transactions, the purchases were completely appropriate. They were purchased at the right kinds of retail outlets, not the ones I listed that we prohibited last year. And in 99.8% of the dollars that were spent, of that $415 million that was referenced earlier, 99.8% were appropriate purchases. They were not frivolous. They were not tattoos. They were not jewelry. They were not unnecessary items. This is what that report said. So when we think about what the potential savings is in terms of the wasted money in terms of cash assistance benefits, we're not talking about a lot. We're talking about $800,000, potentially, out of a $415 million program. Well, we have auditors at DTA, and we have eligibility determination requirements that are going to cut down on some of that, and we have various enforcement activities that are being put in place as we speak by the new DTA commissioner in order to address this extremely small misuse of cash assistance benefits. So, there are unanswered questions in terms of how much this would cost retailers to implement, what the benefits might be for taxpayers, what the cost of enforcement might be, what the cost of implementation might be by DTA. That's why I offer this further amendment, and Mr. Speaker, I ask that my colleagues support this amendment, and I thank you for the opportunity.
Purpose, gentlemen. Chair recognizes Mr. Hill of Ipswich. Chair recognizes Mr. Hill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'll be very brief. I want to thank the gentleman from Wayland for his remarks. I want to thank my friend from Revere for her comments. You folks have given us the reason why we don't need the further amendment. You've talked about the Ripples report. You've talked about the Commission's report. All the answers to the questions that you have been answered during this debate. You've given us facts. You've given us figures. We don't need a further amendment. You have laid out for us tonight your arguments against the underlying amendment. Vote down the further amendment, and let's debate the underlying amendment. You have the information that you need to make a decision on this issue tonight. We don't need to further study it. We have studied it for 3 years. We have two reports that every one of us has received that has answered the questions that may be out there. You answered them for us tonight. This is a way to, in my opinion, hurt democracy in the Massachusetts House. We have been sent up here to vote on issues, not to study them year after year after year. What I do like, in fact, with this issue, is that the studies actually came to fruition. And with those studies, members of my party and others decided to put something forward for consideration of the House. If you don't agree with it, vote it down. If you do agree with it, vote it up. But for heaven's sakes, let's have a vote on the issue. We voted it, as you've already mentioned, my friend from Wayland, we've already voted on this in one budget, and we've already voted on it in a second budget, piecemeal. Let's go the rest of the way and debate the underlying issue, vote it up, vote it down, but let's vote on it. Mr. Speaker, I hope that the further amendment is not adopted.
Chair recognizes Mr. O'Connell of Taunton. Purpose, gentlemen, rise. I recognize the lady from Taunton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. One of the gentlemen at the podium just said that 99.8% of these purchases were found to be appropriate. I have no idea how anyone could possibly know that when 95% of this money is taken out as cash, and we have no idea how it is spent. People are not required to give receipts as to how they spend their money. So there is no way to know how this money is being spent. I'll tell you a few more things about the commission. The consultant twice asked for more time to do this commission study because he was concerned that there wasn't enough time to do a good job. Of course, he was getting $100,000, so he did the job anyway. The research and conclusions from that commission were based on self-reporting of 47 people in a program that has almost 75,000 people. and they were not verified. It was, gee, do you buy anything inappropriate with your money? No, sir, I don't. That is hardly statistically significant. The story that we heard earlier about the folks that were on welfare is exactly why we need to restore integrity to this program so that we can help people that are truly in need. You know, I grew up in public housing on assistance with my mom and my brother and my sister. I know what it's like. I understand it. I feel so lucky to be here today where I am in a position to help other people because I know that a lot of the people that I grew up with are still there, still on public assistance, still in public housing. The IG report that recently came out proved that there is fraud in this program, a minimum of $25 million. More taxpayer dollars fly out the window every single day because people are getting into this program fraudulently. The DTA does not even follow its own rules. Self-verifications allow people to apply for assistance, say anything they want, and get benefits. The information is not verified. Social Security numbers are not required before you get assistance. How can you verify anyone's eligibility without a Social Security number, without the appropriate information about what assets they have, whether or not they have a job, whether or not they have any other income? These things are not being verified. There are waivers in this program for everything. It's supposed to be temporary assistance. Right in the IG's report, we saw there's been people on this program, cash assistance, for 10 years. 10 years because of the waivers for good cause. And those things aren't verified either. And when someone does go on this assistance longer than 2 years, we don't get any federal funding for it. It comes all out of the state. And that's why they can let people stay on for 10 years, because they're not required. The federal government will no longer pay for it. It comes totally out of the taxpayer dollars. We're not reimbursed for any of that money beyond 10 years. These reforms will pay for themselves. If we really want to help the people that truly need it, we have to have high standards in these programs. High standards will allow us to keep people from fraudulently obtaining money so that we can have better programs. We can help people with better educational programs, better job training programs, so that they can get off this assistance and they can be self-sufficient. We do not hurt poor people by stopping fraud in public assistance programs. We do not hurt poor people by keeping those out who are ineligible. I hope the further amendment is not adopted.
Chair recognizes Mr. Spiliotis of Danvers.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and through you to the membership. You know, I've sat patiently and quietly the last few years and listened to all the debate over this subject, and am especially proud of the debate tonight. I think we've toned down our rhetoric, we've spoken about the specifics, and pretty much, if you've looked at the issue, both sides have spoken the truth. Is there abuse? Yes, there is. Is there misabuse? Sure, there is. Is it a program that is difficult to administer? Of course it is. It's called cash assistance. We give cash to the poorest of people in our society. How do you regulate that? Once you've given that cash, the previous speaker is right, it's nearly impossible to monitor. That's the way it is. It started that way before there was ever any EBT cards, before there was credit cards, cash, direct deposit, or any of these modern things. We gave out cash to the poorest of people. That's why it's called cash assistance. That's why it's so important that the people that get the cash deserve to get the cash. The Republican Party, by and large, that's defended, they're exactly right. To prove the integrity of the program, we must have a standard above all everything else, because that's how we're judged. I will, though, place a little qualifier in that. When they say that whatever number it is waste, fraud, and abuse, I'd like to remind people something. In the Commonwealth of Massachusetts today, there's roughly 1,600 people living in hotels and motels. Each one of them, on a temporary basis, each one of those families, today or tomorrow, could be in a different community. Over 200 communities in Massachusetts are helping to transport kids to and from different schools. 200 of our cities and towns. So it's not an isolated issue. It's not an urban issue or a suburban or rural issue. It's everybody's issue. What are we doing in the most difficult of times? Now, one thing that we could debate, and we could debate for hours if we'd like to, is the fact that we are, whether we're proud or not proud of it, the most generous state in the country. Why? Because we're the only state that has a safety net like hotels and motels. No one does it. No one offers that. The gentle lady is right. We have a waiver process that is as generous as anywhere in the country. It's decided by this administration. They're proud of that. It's a policy issue that's worthy of debate. But it's all true. None of it is false. Absolutely none of it. Some of us are proud of it. Some of us find it wrong. I will say, as I started to say a few minutes ago, when you look at waste, fraud, and abuse, the fact that these people are living in hotels one day, on a park bench on another, do you honestly think we can keep track of what their address is? So when we look at those addresses and they come up wrong, think about your list of you trying to track your constituents. What's your percentage of accuracy? And ask that to match it to this agency. See if you come up as good as they come up. Because unlike our list, their lists represent real dollars that we spend, that they try to protect. But the gentle lady is right. The place to address the waste, fraud, and abuse is not to attack every little store in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, or to decide whether somebody should have one brand of butter or another brand or this or that. That's absurd. It's insulting to all of us. The way we do it is to try to limit the people that receive that assistance to those that deserve it. Now, let me tell you, we've seen these our entire career, but this is the list of the new commissioner and her ideas of how she'd like to do it. It's as if she has taken the debate the last few years and has put it on this sheet. She calls it, in pure bureaucratic terms, Bridge to Stability Action Plan, First 100 Days. Now, let me tell you some of the suggestions. Sounds like it comes right from a Republican administration, but it really isn't. It's just common sense. Check with the registry to find out the most recent address. Check income verification with DOR and some system, which I don't have a clue what it means, what you folks may know, Equifax. Check the Social Security numbers to do it. And the list goes on. Check, and this is an interesting one that my community would love, check the local elementary schools to see if there's actually kids in the school that they write the list down. Check our criminal justice system to make sure that these folks aren't wanted. And the list goes on and on, all reasonable requests. We don't need to debate this tonight because we've already gotten the story. We've gotten the message, whether you call it we as Democrats, the Patrick administration, whatever you call it. Now, this is something that we can go back whenever the 100-day clock began and whenever it ends, and the gentle lady can review and have people look at. We can use this study to use it to good effect. Has the administration met the goals of 100 days? Have they not? It's a legitimate question, but it's an ongoing discussion that this chamber started. And this chamber started through the debates on now an annual basis that occur at these wee hours. And I'm, for one guy who's been around a while, quite proud of us for having the debate, proud that we've toned down the rhetoric, proud of the administration to concede that these problems do exist, and proud to be able to discuss it in a reasonable way. So thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes Mr. Enriquez of Boston. House will be in a brief recess. Chair would indicate to the members that the consolidated amendments for public health will be over on the left-hand side of the rostrum. Chair recognizes Mr. Enriquez of Boston.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and through you to the members. I will be very brief, not because of the hour, because I don't think we're really talking about the issue we should be talking about. The issue that we're talking about, we've been talking about EBT, we've been talking about SNAP, we've been talking about food stamps, but the real issue is poverty. Is the system perfect? No. Can we do better? Always. And everything we do, not just this program. But what's painful about this conversation is a room full of people who are charged to serve people who are not talking about any compassion to the poorest of the poor. We're not talking about middle-class families that are one paycheck from losing their mortgage or going under. We're talking about proven poor, far below the poverty line. And I would challenge anyone in this room, who I don't think anyone in this room that draws salary based on taxpayer dollars, currently lives below that poverty line. I would challenge you to use your imagination tonight and ask yourself what it would be like to live on your own, never mind with your family, on $618 of cash a month. And then I would ask you to tell me whether we are talking about treating symptoms or whether we're going to try to cure the illness, the generational illness of poverty that happens over and over in our commonwealth. We've heard that we've had too many studies. While I was sitting over there listening, I used my imagination and I thought about, if I lived off $618 a month, would I have time to get my children to school, work to get off of this assistance, find jobs, get a resume together, travel to these places, and then keep track of the receipts of all my spending? We're far above the poverty line, and I'm sure there's no one in here that keeps 100% track of all their receipts of their spending every single month. And if you raise your hand and say you do, I will call you a liar here on the floor. So I do think we need to do a little bit more studying. If we think that homeowners and people that rent apartments are going to look at a family differently because they're not going to receive cash, then we haven't done enough studying. If we think that people that make $618 a month, I'm sorry, that receive $618 a month can afford internet services so that they can pay their utilities online, we haven't done enough studying. Again, we're discussing treating symptoms when we should be talking about curing the illness. The illness is poverty. We live in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, and what irony to talk about Commonwealth and we're looking at the poorest of the poor and showing them no compassion at all. Is there fraud and abuse? Yes. Are these get-rich schemes? No. No one is getting rich off of this fraud and abuse that is so allegedly so rampant in this system. These are people doing whatever they think it takes to get by day to day and month to month. I've heard a comment that we're not trying to punish poor people. But punishment is a child who becomes homeless or malnutrition because of a decision that someone else made on their behalf. Punitive is being asked to track your receipts for $618 a month while you're trying to get off of that assistance. Again, I'll remind you, this is the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And we're talking about the poorest of the poor. I hope that poverty is a bipartisan issue, and I don't think all of the Democrats have it right. I don't think all the Republicans have it right. I don't think our governor has it right. Until we're going to address poverty as a government, then you can have this debate year after year until we've all come and gone. I hope we start to have the real discussion about poverty. Thank you.
Question now is on the further amendment. Chair recognizes Mr. Lombardo of Billerica.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and through you to the membership. I want to thank my colleagues for sharing so many stories, real-life stories, about those that truly need the benefits that we're hearing about tonight. Very sad stories. Makes you reflect on how lucky we are in our own lives to not need these benefits, many of us in this chamber. And it's been said, and it's worth repeating again, these are the very reasons why we need reform. I want to talk about a few other individuals that are receiving benefits in this program. One gentleman's name is Kimball Clark. Mr. Clark is a convicted drug dealer, assault and battery, cocaine possession. And when he made his one call from jail to his friends, he said, "Go to the ATM, take my EBT card, and get me bail money." Doesn't sound like any child is being fed or housed in that scenario. I want to share with you some findings from the Office of the Inspector General. One applicant claimed she had been unemployed for more than 6 years and her spouse was incarcerated. When reviewing the applicant's bank statements for the weeks that immediately covered the application, monthly summaries revealed deposits totaling more than $7,000 into the account. The office identified 14 cases in their small sample of recipients with active out-of-state addresses. One such case was a recipient who sought benefits on behalf of his daughter. At the same time, the recipient's sister wrote a letter stating that she had been caring for the brother's child since 2007. The letter dictated that the sister had lived in Georgia, raising a really legitimate question about the residency of the child. Further investigation on this case showed that the recipient had several active addresses and identifications from the state of New York. ...3,242 people from the age of 18 to 68 with no Social Security numbers, placeholder Social Security numbers, receiving benefits. What do we know about these individuals? Do they qualify for benefits? Are they taking benefits away from those who really need it? We don't know. Another case that the Inspector General found, that a recipient receiving benefits while she was incarcerated. Another case, a recipient wrote a letter to the Department of Transitional Assistance explaining that she could not cooperate with DOR because the absent father was a good father who visited every other day with the child and provided a small monetary support. The recipient signed an absent parent affidavit in January of 2010, after the birth of that child, stating that the father had been continuously absent and she didn't know his whereabouts. 18 months later, the recipient gave birth to a second child and named the same father. 7 months later, she signed another affidavit saying that the child's father had been continuously absent, and the recipient did not know his whereabouts. Another case, grantee's husband inherited a multi-unit apartment building. The grantee stated that she was separated from her husband. Further investigation showed that they were living together and that the husband was in fact gainfully employed. The conclusions and recommendations of the IG's report identified eligibility concerns in the following categories: undisclosed assets, real property, and vehicles, undisclosed employment income, the use of placeholder Social Security numbers, missing verifications associated with residency, participation in employment services, citizenship or immigration status, absent parent information, immunizations, and the relationship status between recipients and children. So all the information I've heard tonight about these real life stories of people who do indeed need these benefits, and the information I have from reading the Inspector General's reports has led me to one question. Why do we have rules? Why do we bother? It appears that if you break the rules, it's okay. So why bother have them? You know, the point of rules are to ensure that those who need the assistance get the assistance. That the integrity of the program is real. When I see that 381 cases that the Inspector General reviewed found 380 issues, it tells me we're not doing something right. Seems like there is a large margin for improvements. And to suggest tonight that these reforms would harm those that need the benefits is just wrong. I think one person said insulting. I think that is insulting. Because if you're following the rules, if you meet the criteria to receive benefits, you will do so. We're not punishing anyone at all. We're ensuring that if you are playing by the rules, that you'll be able to have a benefit there to assist your family and to take care of your children. One other thing that struck me about this debate tonight, everyone is very knowledgeable on this issue. Very knowledgeable. Everyone spoke very well, with conviction. Seems like there are strong opinions on this issue, and I think that's great, no matter how you come down on the issue. Which just further proves that we don't need to study this. I think the governor likes to say political courage. Let's have political courage tonight. Let's vote down a study. Doesn't seem like there's much more to study. Let's vote on the issue. You vote your conscience, you vote how you believe this amendment should be judged, and let's get to the main issue. We've had enough of these studies that don't accomplish anything. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
On the amendment, on the further amendment, Chair recognizes Mr. Jones of North Reading.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and let me begin by commending my colleagues on what I think has been an enlightening and civil debate. It's actually, quite frankly, kind of nice when one breaks out around here. We should do it more often. One of the words I heard from the previous speakers talk about is the word compassion. And somehow if you support the underlying amendment, at least the inference is that if you support the underlying amendment, You lack compassion. And if you're against the underlying amendment, you're compassionate. Which sort of compels me to talk about a few of the things I've been involved in. My first office was on the Housing Authority, a small housing authority. But working with people who were in need, who were looking for help, who were looking for assistance. But I never thought it was too much to ask as part of that compact, there were certain rules and regulations. And one of the things that I was always high on ensuring was that if you were a recipient of public housing, you took care of it. Because hopefully you were only going to be a temporary occupant of it, and that maybe when you moved on to something better, hopefully in self-sufficiency, that housing would be in good condition and available to someone else who then needed it. And then one of the other issues I got involved with when I was a legislator and on the Board of Selectmen was we had a group home coming town for brain-injured people. And working very hard with my community to waive all the permitting fees and building fees to get that done. And I drive by that group home every single day on the way to work and every single day on the way home. And some days, I get to see some of those clients in their wheelchair on their way over to get their Dunkin' Donuts cup of coffee. And it's a great thing, because those are people who need help. Now, the gentleman from Wayland talked about why we need this study, and he was eloquent and compelling. And my one question to him is, then why isn't there a date certain when the study will be done? Why not? Because the reality is, to quote myself from a few days ago, it's a charade. Now, in 2010, this debate started to percolate about tobacco and alcohol and lottery. And at the time, the governor, who was running for re-election, said, yeah, we need to make those fixes, but really, the evidence is more anecdotal. That we were making a mountain out of a molehill. And in 2011, the gentlelady from Taunton, working with the Republican Leader's Office and the members of the caucus and members of the legislature, made some initial changes, and we had a commission. And then we took that commission report and we worked on some of the recommendations and included it in the 2012 budget. Excuse me, in the budget we debated during 2012. And we created the Cashless Commission. And we've seen the OIG report. And we've seen the OIG report highlight issues that were raised, I believe, by the auditor in 2004. So there comes a little cynicism that legitimate issues that are raised aren't addressed. Hence the desire to codify some of those issues. Now last year when these types of amendments were filed, there was an attempt to sit down and reach a consensus or a compromise. And as I recall, the gentleman from Wayland didn't love the compromise that was reached back then. I may be wrong, but I think by his nodding that he disagreed with what the approach we did. And there were others who thought we didn't go far enough. And I will say, I know there's been a lot of talking about, you know, people posturing in the extremes. But I don't think if there were those of us trying to go further, that we would have come as far as we have. Let me say that again. If there weren't those of us trying to go further, we would not come as far as we have. Now, it's interesting. My good friend from Revere talked about the Cashless Commission. And a couple of the recommendations of the commission are included in the underlying amendment. So if we're going to extol the virtues of that commission report, why aren't we at least adopting some of the things they recommended we do? We could have done that in a different fashion than say, well, we need to study it and wipe everything out. Now, this has been, again, as I started remarks, I think a superior debate. First and foremost, because people have actually been listening. And quite frankly, that's one of the things we should all be about, listening. Because I think even those of us who support the underlying amendment learn something when we listen to those who may prefer a study or are against the underlying amendment. And hopefully the reverse is true. But it's unfortunate. The gentlelady from Revere referred to the photo IDs that were required in the bill that came out of Ways and Means. Quite frankly, one of the things that we put in there was some timelines. When would that happen? I think that's pretty reasonable. Standards to evaluate success. And I referenced the governor earlier, and I think the fact that the governor relieved his DTA commissioner, I would say, is proof positive that the arguments many of us raised, especially members of the second division, but many of us in this chamber raised, were validated. And our caucus had, I think, a productive meeting with the new commissioner, interim commissioner. And we're impressed. And some of the things that I think we try to do, we try to codify those. So they're not sort of, well, we're doing them now, and then as maybe the spotlight fades away, we can get away from doing those. But, and maybe I'll end here because I know the hour's late and I know there's other things to get done, but you can be assured, Mr. Speaker, that no one in the second division wants to see anyone deserving of benefits go without benefits. And in fact, I would make the argument that what we are about is balancing the compact with beneficiaries and clients with the compact we owe to the taxpayers who call up and say, I'm working two jobs or three jobs to make ends meet. Why is this happening? So that maybe that the lady, that the gentlelady from Revere referenced, we could be more helpful to. That's what this debate is about. And I think the gentleman from Ipswich was right on, as were other members. If you're against the underlying amendment, then just vote against it. You've raised some good arguments. But let's not do this further amendment with no date that we all know is a charade. I mean, you know, come on. We're better than that. We're better than that because we've shown that by the civil, reasoned debate we've had tonight. And quite frankly, I hope we have a few more. I hope the further amendment's not adopted.
Question now is on the further amendment. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed. Roll call haven't been ordered. The roll call machine is now open. Remain open for 3 minutes. Court officer, some of the members indicate a roll call is in progress. Who asked for a roll call? Pardon me? Have all members voted wish to do so? Have all members voted who wish to do so? Have all members voted wish to do so? Time for voting has expired. The clerk will display the tally on this matter. 105 members voting in the affirmative, 51 in the negative. The further amendment is adopted. Question now is on adoption of the amendment. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed, no. The ayes have it. The amendment is adopted. Mr. Jones of North Reading offers an amendment in the hands of the clerk. Clerk, read the amendment.
Amendment number 387. Mr. Jones of North Reading and other members of the House move to amend the bill by striking out Section 5, inserting place of the following section, Section 5. Section 16 of Chapter 6A of the General Laws is most recently amended by Section 5 of Chapter 224 of the Acts of 2012, is hereby further amended by inserting at the end there the following paragraphs. The Executive Office of Health and Human Services.
Chair recognizes Mr. Conroy. There be no objection. The clerk will dispense with the remainder of the reading of the paper. The chair has none. Chair recognizes Mr. Conroy of Wayland.
I have a further amendment.
Gentleman has a further amendment, which he will hand to the clerk. Clerk, I'll read the further amendment.
Mr. Conroy of Wayland moves to amend the amendment number 387 by adding the following. Notwithstanding any special or general law to the contrary, the provisions of sections 5, 86, 89.
If there be no objection, the clerk will dispense with the further reading of the paper. Chair has none. Question now comes on the adoption of the further amendment. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed, nay. The ayes have it. The further amendment is adopted. What purpose does the gentleman rise? Mr. Jones moves. When the vote be taken by call of the yeas and nays, those joining with them arise. The monitors will count the first division. 16. Sufficient number having arisen. The matter will be taken by a call of the yeas and nays. Roll call machine is now open. Remain open for 3 minutes. Court officers, some of the members indicate a roll call is in progress. Have all members voted wish to do so? Have all members voted? Time for voting has expired. The clerk will display the tally. On this matter, 110 members voted in the affirmative, 46 in the negative. The further amendment is now adopted. Mr. Norton of Clinton asks unanimous consent to be recorded in the last roll call. Chair objection, chair has none.
On roll call number 96, Harold P. Norton, Jr., yes.
Question hours on adoption of the amendment as amended. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed nay. The ayes have it. The amendment is adopted as amended.
Sullivan of Fall River.
Mr. Sullivan of Fall River asks unanimous consent to be recorded on the last roll call. Chair objection, chair has none.
David Sullivan on roll call 97. Yes.
Clerk will recall David Sullivan.
Roll call 97. David Sullivan, no.
Question now is on passing the bill to be engrossed, pending which Ms. O'Connell of Taunton offers an amendment in the hands of the clerk. Clerk will read the amendment.
Amendment number 848. Representative O'Connell of Taunton and other members of the House move to amend the bill by adding the following section. Not more than 25% of the recipients shall be exempt from the Employment Services Program requirement, provided that the reason for exemption must be clearly documented and reevaluated every 3 months for approval, provided further that the department shall directly contact on a monthly basis the provider of the education or training activity listed on the participation and attendance form to verify recipient participation in ESP.
Question now is on the amendment. Chair recognizes Ms. O'Connell of Taunton. As the lady approaches the microphone, members are asked to take their seats and pay due attention to the lady. Please subdue your conversation. This chair recognizes Ms. O'Connell of Taunton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and through you to the members. This amendment would require that only 25% of people can get the exemption from the work requirement on the EBT program. As we've heard all evening, there are waivers for everything in this program. There is supposed to be a work requirement. It helps people to be responsible, to maintain their skills, to look for jobs, to get further education. Unfortunately, over 50% of the people on the program get waivers for this work requirement. And we saw in the IG's report that some of them are from, again, self-declarations. So we need to ensure that people are working, that they are fulfilling their requirements. A lot of these work requirements, people are just filling out a piece of paper saying, you know, I volunteer at the library and I'm filling my work requirement. That is not good enough. We have got to stop the honor system in this program, and we have got to help people. And when we hold people responsible, when we have high standards, when we expect a lot from them, that is when we help them, when we give them self-esteem and help them move to self-sufficiency. So we do that by adopting this amendment and requiring, ensuring that only 25% of people on public assistance will be able to be exempt from the federal work requirement. I hope the amendment is adopted.
Question now is on the amendment. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed, nay. The nays have it. The amendment and is not adopted. What purpose does the gentleman rise? Gentleman doubts the vote. Ask for a roll call. First division.
Zero.
Zeros. Second division. 16. Sufficient number having arisen. Roll call machine is now open. Remain open for 3 minutes. Court officer, some of the members indicated roll call is in progress. Have all members voted wish to do so? Have all members voted wish to do so? Time for voting has expired. The clerk will display the tally. On this matter, 131 members vote in the affirmative, 125 in the negative. The amendment is not adopted. Question now is on passing the bill to be engrossed, pending which Ms. O'Connell of Taunton offers an amendment in the hands of the clerk. Clerk will read the amendment.
Amendment number 753. Ms. O'Connell of Taunton and other members of the House move to amend the bill. Section 2 in item 7004, double lot 99, in lines 10, 15, 17, and 20, by striking out the following, may, and inserting in place of the following, shall.
Question now is on the amendment. Chair recognizes Ms. O'Connell of Taunton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and through you to the members.
Chair will respectfully ask the members to subdue their conversation. Chair recognizes Ms. O'Connell of Taunton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This amendment will require applicants, tenants, and household members to provide a social security number in order to verify income eligibility for housing. In Massachusetts, you do not have to provide any proof of citizenship or immigration to qualify for housing, and an applicant cannot be denied for failure to provide a Social Security number. How could eligibility possibly be determined when you don't verify the income and assets of everyone in that household? Again, it is not happening. They're not following the rules. This policy allows illegal immigrants to qualify for public housing and get in line in front of people that are here lawfully.
Purpose, gentlemen, rise. Gentlemen having difficulty hearing the speaker at the podium.
Thank you.
At the dais. Subdue your conversations. Chair recognizes Mr. O'Connell of Taunton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Our policy right now of letting people get housing without social security numbers allows people that are here illegally to get in line in front of those that are here legally, to get in line in front of veterans who have fought for this country, in front of seniors who have built the very foundations of our communities.
Purpose, gentlemen, rise. Chair will respectfully ask the members to please subdue your conversation, pay attention to the lady at the dais. Chair recognizes Ms. O'Connell of Taunton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. People that don't provide Social Security numbers can get in line for housing in front of struggling families that are here legally. This state has got to stop rewarding people who are not playing by the rules and doing that by handing them taxpayer-funded benefits. And the other issue is a safety issue. How can you do a query check on people for housing when they don't provide a Social Security number? There are children in these housing units that need to be protected from criminals, from sex offenders, and the query checks are not able to be performed as well. This is the right thing to do. I hope the amendment is adopted.
Question hours on the amendment. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed, nay. The nays have it. Amendment is not adopted. What purpose, gentlemen, rise? Gentlemen, ask for a call of the ayes and nays. Those joining with them rise. If Lonzo return the count. First division, 0. Second division. Second division, 16. Sufficient number having arisen. Roll call machine is now open. Remain open for 3 minutes. Court officers, some of the members indicated roll call is in progress. The clerk will call Mr. Sullivan.
David Sullivan. David Sullivan, answer is present.
Have all members voted wish to do so? Have all members voted? Time for voting has expired. The clerk will display the tally. On this matter, 43 members voted in the affirmative, 101 in the negative. The amendment is not adopted. Mr. Collins, Mr. Enriquez, Mr. Cantwell, Mr. Collinger, Ms. Atkins, all ask unanimous consent to be recorded in the last roll call. Chair objection, chair has none.
On roll call number 99, Corey Atkins, no. Nick Collins, no. James Cantwell, no. Carlo Enrique, no. John Long, no.
Ms. Decker of Cambridge, Mr. Mikowitz of Boston, Mr. Moran of Boston, Mr. Rogers of Cambridge. Who? Yeah, Mr. Carpenter of Boston. Ask unanimous consent, Ms. Forey of Boston. Ask unanimous consent to be recorded in the last roll call. Chair here objection, chair has none.
Marjorie Decker, no. Aaron Mikowitz, no. Edward Carpenter, no. David Rogers, no. Michael Moran, no. Linda Dorsina Forey, no.
I got you. You were the first.
Question now is on passing the bill of being gross, pending which Ms. O'Connell of Taunton offers an amendment in the hands of the clerk. The clerk will read the amendment.
Amendment number 790, Ms. O'Connell of Taunton moves to amend the bill. Striking out Section 16, certain places of the following section, Section 16. Section 10 of Chapter 18, as appearing in the 2010 official edition, hereby amended by inserting after the word court in line 2, the words House and Senate Committees on Ways and Means.
Question now is on the amendment. The chair recognizes Ms. O'Connell prior to the lady coming to the chair. Mr. Cantwell of Marshfield asks unanimous consent to be recorded in the last roll call. 98.
On roll call number 98, James Cantwell, no.
Question now comes on the adoption of the amendment. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed, nay. The nays have it. The amendment is not adopted. Mr. Norton of Clinton asks unanimous consent to be recorded in the last roll call. Chair objection, chair has none.
Roll call number 99, Harold P. Norton, Jr., no.
John, you were all set. John? John, you were all set.
Yeah, I was all
set. Yes.
Question now is passed on the bill of being gross pending which Ms. O'Connell of Taunton offers an amendment in the hands of the clerk. Clerk, I'll read the amendment.
Amendment number 840. Ms. O'Connell of Taunton moves to amend the bill. Inserting after section 15, the following section, section 15. Section 5.
If there be no objection, the clerk will dispense with the reading of the paper. Question now is on adoption. The chair recognizes Ms. O'Connell of Taunton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and through you to the members.
Please pay due attention to the lady at the dais. Chair recognizes Ms. O'Connell of Taunton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and through you to the members. This amendment will ensure that penalties are enforced in the EBT system. We passed reforms in 2011 that require that prohibited the purchase of alcohol, tobacco products, and lottery tickets. And I asked the question of DTA, and I have been told that there have been no violations. No one has incurred any penalties for those violations. I cannot believe that those violations have not occurred. We need to require openness and transparency in the EBT system by requiring violation hearings and penalties to be public. The public needs to know what's going on in these programs. We know from the recent IG report, IG audit, that DTA...
Purpose, gentlemen, rise. Members cannot hear the lady at the microphone. Request that members subdue their conversation, pay due attention to the lady. What person, gentlemen, rise. Does the lady yield?
Sure.
Chair recognizes Mr. O'Connell of Taunton.
No, public floggings are not part of the penalties, and I do not support that at all. We do know, however, from the recent IG audit that the DTA is not enforcing their own rules and not enforcing the penalties. We don't even know if these hearings are happening. We are taking and giving responsibility for some of this to another bureau. We need to make sure that when taxpayer money is funding a program, that the rules are enforced. If there are no penalties, then there's no reason to follow the rules. We need to restore integrity to this program. This is an important program. We need to ensure that the penalties are enforced and that the people who truly need assistance are getting assistance in these programs. I hope the amendment is adopted.
Question now is on the amendment. Who's that? Mr. Valdigo? Chair recognizes. Hard to see. Chair recognizes Mr. Deal.
From Whitman, we...
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and through you to the membership. I don't know if anybody's been checking the news lately. There's a breaking story from the Herald. If you care to check your iPads, your phones, anything like that, the Herald's reporting that the terrorist, I don't even know how you say his name, Tamerlan Tsarnaev, was receiving EBT benefits, driving a Mercedes, but receiving EBT benefits. And we're not talking about penalties, we're talking about further studying or not penalizing people who are clearly violating EBT regulations. If the system is not wrought with fraud, when somebody like this is receiving benefits, I don't know what is. Mr. Speaker, I ask the membership to pass the amendment, and when the vote is taken, I ask it be taken by a call of the yeas and nays.
Mr. Deal of Whitman asks when the matter is taken to be taken by a call of yeas and nays. Those joining with them will rise. Monitor the turn to count. First division, 0. Second division, 16. Sufficient number having arisen. Roll call machine is now open. What purpose, gentlemen? Yes. Chair recognizes Mr. Lyons of Andover.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The I think the Inspector General's report needs a little bit more attention tonight. You've had enough? I really believe that we continue to hear that people are receiving benefits, and we're making the argument, as clearly people can hear, that there is abuse and fraud within the system. And there are rules. There are rules. And one of the rules is that each member must be a United States citizen. And a Social Security number must be provided for each member. Yet the Department of Transitional Assistance doesn't require that. So it would seem to me that the leadership of the Patrick administration.
Purpose of the gentleman rise. Does the gentleman yield?
Yes.
Gentleman yields.
I will.
You stated that they have to be U.S. citizens to qualify. Is that correct, that information?
Chair recognizes Mr. Cabral of New Bedford.
The question is that information correct? My understanding, you have to be a legal citizen. You can be a U.S. citizen or a legal resident of the Commonwealth.
Chair recognizes Mr. Lyons of Andover.
Thank you, sir. Each member, I'll read it so you can, so I'll read what it says in the Inspector General's report. Each member of the assistance unit must be a United States citizen, an eligible non-citizen as defined in 106 CMR 203.675. A Social Security number must be provided.
Gentleman has the microphone.
For each member of the assistant unit. So those are rules that are already in place. Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Lyons has the floor.
So as discussed previously, if an applicant does not provide the required information about citizenship or immigration status, he or she is ineligible to receive benefits. Citizenship or immigration status. To be eligible for benefits, each member of the assistance must provide proof that he is a citizen of the United States, an eligible non-citizen as defined in 106 CMR. If the applicant does not provide acceptable information about his citizenship or immigration status, he is ineligible to receive benefits. Proof of citizenship or immigration status is a threshold eligibility requirement. It doesn't say that proof of citizenship or immigration status is a punishment. It says that it is a threshold eligibility requirement. In 2004, the Department of Transitional Assistance Technology Controls by the state auditor recommended that the DTA tighten its oversight on what they refer to as placeholder Social Security numbers. 2004, instituting strict time limits on their validity, creating an automated system to remind recipients to provide actual Social Security number. As of the date of this report, which was in February 2013, 7 years after the Patrick administration took over this program, the DTA has not implemented the state auditor's report and recommendations. When an ineligible grantee is unable or unwilling to provide a Social Security number, the DTA will stop efforts to obtain documentations or ask additional questions. In particular, the DTA does not appear to question.
Chair would respectfully indicate to the gentleman that he should keep his remarks to the amendment.
Thank you, sir. The DTA does not appear to question whether the applicant has a Social Security number or not. I think the point that I'm trying to make, and I hope that the speaker will allow me to make it, is that these are not rules that we're trying to create tonight. And I would just ask everyone, as we go forward, to recognize the gentle lady from Taunton has done an incredible job bringing this issue to the attention of this chamber and this Commonwealth. And I believe that we have as a responsibility to try to make sure that the rules that are in place are followed. And as a legislature, I believe that it is my responsibility to at least have some understanding of what the Department of Transitional Assistance rules are. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Roll call machine is now open. Remain open. Roll call machine is now open. You can't, you cannot interrupt a roll call. The roll call machine is now open. Remain open for 3 minutes. And once again, we'll tell you that you cannot interrupt a roll call. Have all members voted wish to do so? Have all members voted wish to do so? We will ask the members to stay close to the chamber as we will have multiple roll calls. Have all members voted wish to do so? What's the matter? Have all members voted? Time for voting has expired. The clerk will take the tally. First, those voting in favor, 40 members voting in favor, 116 in the negative. The amendment is not adopted. Question now is on passing the bill to be engrossed, pending which Ms. O'Connell offers an amendment in the hands of the clerk.
Amendment number 814, Ms. O'Connell of Taunton and other members of the House move to amend the bill by adding the following section. Self-declaration shall not be permitted as a means of verifying eligibility information for any form of public assistance.
For the purpose of the lady rise. Lady will state her point of order.
I believe the amendment is out of order because the House already voted to study this subject.
The chair will state that since the House has at this reading adopted an amendment to study the subject matter contained in the proposed amendment, adoption of the amendment filed by the lady from Taunton would contradict the provision added by the amendment. Therefore, the chair will rule that the point of order is well taken and the amendment will be laid aside accordingly. What purpose the lady rise? Lady doubts the ruling of the chair and asks for call. Roll call haven't been ordered. The roll call machine is. No, there's no roll call. Chair is in. The amendments are laid aside. Next. Ms. O'Connell offers an amendment in the hands of the clerk.
Amendment number 828. Ms. O'Connell of Taunton moves to amend the bill and other members of the House in section 15 in line 147 by inserting after the word older the words provided that said electronic transfer benefits card shall have a photo of the cardholder by January 1, 2014.
What purpose the lady rise?
Point of order.
The lady will state her point of order.
I believe the amendment before us is out of order because the House already voted to study this subject.
The chair will state that since the House has at this reading adopted an amendment to study the subject matter contained in the proposed amendment, adoption of the amendment filed by the lady from Taunton would contradict the provision added by the amendment. Therefore, the chair will rule that the point of order is well taken and the amendment will be laid aside accordingly. What purpose of the lady rise? The lady doubts the ruling of the chair. There was a second. Quells, shall the decision of the chair stand? All those in favor say aye. All those opposed, no. The ayes have it. The decision of the chair stands. What purpose does the gentleman rise? Gentleman doubts the vote, calls for the ayes and nays. Those joining with them will rise. The monitors will return the count. First division. Zero. Second division. Second division. 16th. Sufficient number have arisen. Roll call machine is now open. Remain open for 2 minutes. The roll call machine is open. Remain open for 2 minutes. The hell is the matter with my button? Oh, okay. Once again, the members are asked to remain in the chamber for multiple roll calls. On roll call number 100, Mr. Carpenter of Boston asks unanimous consent to be recorded. All those in favor say aye, all those opposed nay, the ayes have it. Oh, chair is in error.
Mr. Carpenter of Boston on roll call number 100, no.
Have all members voted wish to do so? Have all members voted? On this matter, 142 members voting yea, 13 members voting nay. The decision of the chair stands. Mr. O'Connell of Taunton offers an amendment in the hands of the clerk. Ms. DiZoglio of Methuen asks unanimous consent to be recorded in the last roll call. Chair objection, chair is none.
On roll call number 101, Diana DiZoglio, yes.
Ms. O'Connell of Taunton offers an amendment in the hands of the clerk. Clerk, I'll read the amendment.
Roll call number 838, amendment number 838, Ms. O'Connell of Taunton moves to amend the bill by adding the following section. No form of public assistance shall be granted to an individual who has not presented a valid Social Security number that has been verified.
What purpose does the lady rise? Lady will say to point of order.
I believe the amendment before is out of order because the House already voted to study this subject.
The chair will state that since the House has at this reading adopted an amendment to study the subject matter contained in the proposed amendment, adoption of the amendment filed by the lady from Taunton would contradict the provision added by the amendment. Therefore, the chair will rule that the point of order is well taken and the amendment will be laid aside accordingly. Ms. Taunton, Ms. O'Connell of Taunton.
No, I was never Ms. Taunton. I doubt the ruling of the chair and ask for call of the yeas and nays.
Ms. O'Connell of Taunton offers an amendment in the hands of the clerk. The clerk will read the amendment.
Amendment number 878. Ms. O'Connell, Taunton, and other members of the House move to amend the bill by striking out section 5 and setting place of the following.
If there be no objection, the clerk will dispense with the reading of the paper. Purpose of the lady rise?
Sir?
Lady was saying a point of order.
I believe the amendment before is out of order because the House already voted to study this subject.
The chair will state that since the House has at this reading adopted an amendment to study the subject matter contained in the proposed amendment, adoption of the amendment filed by the lady from Taunton would contradict the provision added by the amendment. Therefore, the chair will rule that the point of order is well taken and the amendment will be laid aside accordingly. Chair recognizes Ms. O'Connell of Taunton.
I doubt the ruling of the chair and ask for a call of the yeas and nays.
The lady doubts the rule of the chair. Ms. O'Connell offers an amendment in the hands of the clerk. Clerk will read the amendment.
Amendment number 880. Ms. O'Connell of Taunton and other members of the House move to amend the bill by adding the following sections. Section 5J of Chapter 18 of the General Laws is most recently amended by Chapter 161.
If there be no objection, the clerk will dispense with the reading of the paper. Chair has objection. Chair has none.
Speaker.
What purpose the lady rise?
Point of order.
Lady will state a point of order.
I believe the amendment before us is out of order because the House already voted to study this subject.
The chair will state that since the House has at this reading adopted an amendment to study the subject matter contained in the proposed amendment, adoption of the amendment filed by the lady from Taunton would contradict the provision added by the amendment. Therefore, the chair will rule that the point of order is well taken and the amendment will be laid aside accordingly. But chair recognizes Ms. O'Connell of Taunton.
I doubt the ruling of the chair.
Second.
Ms. O'Connell of Taunton offers an amendment in the hands of the clerk. The clerk will read the amendment.
Amendment number 820. Ms. O'Connell of Taunton and other members of the House move to amend the bill in section 88 in line 1310 by inserting after the word attendance the words provided that, in accordance with the regulations of the department, the guarantee shall be put on probation and benefits shall be suspended for 6 months or until the guarantee provides proof that the child is regularly attending school.
Question now is on the amendment. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed, nay. The nays have it. The amendment is not adopted. Ms. O'Connell of Taunton offers an amendment in the hands of the clerk. The clerk will read the amendment. Mr. Cantwell of Mansfield asks for unanimous consent to be recorded on roll call 101. Chair here objection. Chair has none.
On roll call number 101, James Cantwell, yes.
Ms. O'Connell of Taunton offers an amendment. Hands it to clerk. Clerk will read the amendment.
Amendment number 871. Ms. O'Connell of Taunton moves to amend the bill by inserting in section 6 after the word cases the following. D. In addition to the responsibility.
D being no objection, clerk will dispense with the reading of the paper. Chair has none. Question now is on adoption of the amendment. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed, nay. The nays have it. The amendment is not adopted. Okay. The lady doubts the vote of the chair and asks for a call of the yeas and nays. Those joining with her will rise. Monitors return the count. First division. Sarah, second division. Second division. Six. We're challenging the members are challenging the division. Recount the division in the second division. Monitors will recount. More than sufficient having arisen, roll call machine is now open and will remain open for 2 minutes. So court officers, some of the members indicated roll call is in progress. Have all members voted wish to do so? Have all members voted? Time for voting has expired. The clerk will display the tally. On this matter, 32 members voting in the affirmative, 125 in the negative. The amendment is not adopted. Mr. O'Connell of Taunton offers an amendment in the hands of the clerk. The clerk will read the amendment.
Amendment number 733, Ms. O'Connell of Taunton, Mr. Hunt of Sandwich, move to amend the bill by adding the following section. Notwithstanding any general or special law to the contrary.
If there be no objection, the clerk will dispense with the reading of the paper. The chair has none. Chair recognizes Mr. Conroy of Wayland. Gentleman has a further amendment to place in the hands of the clerk. Clerk will read the further amendment.
Mr. Conroy of Wayland has...
Gentleman has stated his point of order.
11:59.
We'll have, according to my watch, it's 11:58. Clerk will read the amendment. Clerk will read the amendment. Clerk, read. Shall the decision of the chair stand? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay.
No.
The decision of the chair stands. The clerk will read the further amendment.
Mr. Conroy of Wayland has moved that the amendment offered by Lady, amendment number 733 be amended by adding the following.
The gentleman cannot interrupt while the clerk is reading the amendment.
By adding the at the end of the following paragraph, notwithstanding a general or special law to the contrary, the provisions of this section shall not take effect until such time as one.
If there be no objection, the clerk will dispense with the reading of the paper. The chair has none. Question now is on the further amendment. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed, nay. The ayes have it. The further... What purpose the gentleman rise? Gentleman doubts the vote. Ask for call of the ayes and nays. Those joining with them will rise. Monitors return the count. First division. 16. Sufficient number having arisen. Roll call machine is now open. Remain open for 1 minute.
This is on the adoption of the further amendment. It's announced that this is on adoption of the further amendment. No. But on the board, it says adoption of amendment. You can have time to switch it. I know. Yeah. You said 1 minute, but it's a 2 minute.
Have all members voted wish to do so? Have all members voted wish to do so? Time for voting has expired. The clerk will display the tally. On this matter, 128 members voted in the affirmative, 29 in the negative. The further amendment is adopted. Chair would like to indicate, when question now comes on adoption of the amendment as amended. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed, nay. The ayes have it. The amendment as amended is adopted. Chair would like to indicate to the members, we don't anticipate any further roll calls this evening. We are just clarifying as to when we're going to meet, as we all know that there's a memorial service, and we want to just make sure that we have the right time. Session will begin tomorrow, Wednesday, at 2, and roll calls will begin at 3 p.m. Mr. Rushing of Boston now moves that the House stands in recess till the hour of 2 p.m.